All right, welcome to Useful Idiots. I'm Matt Taibbi.
I'm Katie Halper.
We have a really good show.
Really good show.
This week, we're going to be talking to Max Blumenthal, but we're going to start with the most important thing that's ever happened in the United States of America.
Definitely, but also make sure you rate and review us on iTunes.
Right.
Oh, sorry. That was me just moving
Katie,
my mug.
That was terrible.
Sorry, that was me moving my mug.
You were moving your mug?
Yeah.
And here, it made that noise?
Yeah, let's see. Watch. Now, why do I say that? Why do I say that?
This is such a bad setup.
It's so great. Okay, because
so ham-handed.
There's an incident this week, something that happened this,
Yep.
Oh, Matt has a much different, his mug. That was a silent but deadly
SPD.
Mug. Yeah. So there was some controversy because Eric Swalwell, who Swalwell.
Yeah.
I think I probably misspelled
that. He ran for president. You might have remembered.
I know. Yeah. Did he even make it into any of our trivia or discussions at all?
He was the first person to. He was the first victim in Crystal Lake.
Crystal Lake. Yeah.
Right in the opening credits, there was an axe in his head.
Yeah.
Trailblazer. Yep.
On that, and a trailblazer in another field, which we'll get to right now. But
he was the Russiagate candidate. So he was the person who was he was basically the other version of Adam Schiff.
Okay,
and
got
so
it.
He was the most aggressive on and.
Wow, and that didn't get him to the front of the.
It did. Did not launch him to the front of the pack.
So he was on Chris Matthews, and there's a big controversy over who is responsible for this. And by the way, it's called Fartgate. That's the hashtag.
Fantastic.
It gave birth
Fartgate.
To. And today is Tuesday when we're taping is International Toilet Day.
It's what day?
International Toilet Day.
Not
kidding.
It's like a theme
I'm not
with our show.
That up. I know. Yeah, and also International Men's Day.
Oh, really?
So
no.
Toilet, yeah, yeah. Okay. So Eric Swalwell was talking to Chris Matthews, would love to say friend of the show, amusing guy of the show, Hardball. And I like the way he says water. New Hampshire. He's so crazy. It's like he doesn't get that he has a show. It's like he still can't believe it. I remember watching him once and he was like, and then when we get back, we're talking about New Hampshire.
Sort of flexing his mouth in front of the camera.
Yeah. So anyway, so let's go to the videotape.
Taxpayer dollars to ask the Ukrainians to help them cheat an election. And the complaint that I've heard from
this is real, apparently. And there's controversy. Now, I already knew it was Chris Matthews. Here's how I knew. Now, to be fair, it looks like Swalwell because he makes a gesture that's kind of in time with it.
Really?
Yeah.
Let's examine this. This is like the Zapruder film. This is awesome.
Taxpayer dollars to ask the Ukrainians to help them cheat an election. And the complaint that I've heard from...
He moves forward right after. But that doesn't make sense. You do that before you do it. Not after, which is why it's just pure coincidence.
It was almost like he was ducking to get out of the way. Let's see it again.
Taxpayer dollars to ask the Ukrainians to help them cheat an election.
So it's like there was a drive-by. Maybe it was a fart-by, a fart-gate. Someone farted by.
He can see it.
And he was trying to, he can see it.
It was green and coming
maybe
at
some,
him.
Or maybe someone like went like, the, you know, like lifted their butt right in front of him and we can't see it. But here's the thing. If that's real, and it is, I knew that that audio is not from him. Because he's like in the halls of Congress or whatever, and you can tell that it's just too loud. The mic wouldn't have picked that up, and I'm not just saying that. Essie Cupp also said that.
Well,
now,
okay.
I don't live by Essie Cupp or her tweets, but I do. But she did say something as someone who, you know, is often mic'd and out and about, I guess, and covering stuff. But it sounded too like, what's it called in a movie when you have two tracks? It's like crew people. You know this because you're video film people. It's like the soundtrack is when it's in the movie. What is it? Diegetic, you know, one of them sounds like it's there in studio. That
right.
sounds like an in-studio fart, is what I'm saying. And lest we had any doubts about that, you know, let's go to the tweet of the Chris Matthews.
Wait, okay, go ahead.
Oh, sorry, no, I don't want to cut you off.
What I would say is, I think,
you're going to push back.
Forensically, the way I would analyze this is more about just the quality of the fart and
right.
what kind of fart it was. So can we hear it again?
Oh, I see.
Taxpayer dollars right. to ask the Ukrainians to help them cheat an election.
If it were Swalwell, it would be like more of a narrower, more athletic kind of a fart.
Like a
more high pitched.
Right.
That's clearly more of a flabby, flappy old guy fart.
Yeah, that has
got a little bit of that, kind of
reverb.
It's sonorous
whatever,
a little bit, you know? I'm not going to point a finger, but I think
You're
going to pull the finger. Right. Yeah. In this tableau, I think the suspect, right. They pretty clearly...
This may be the best artistic analysis, like, we've ever done. We're talking about form, we're talking about content.
That's
we're talking
right.
About, yeah, this is great. We got to get an art historian to come in, or a film historian to come in and look at this. Wouldn't that be great?
Yeah, what would they call a fart expert?
Fart
a flatulist.
Flatulist, yeah.
But no, that's someone who farts.
Yeah, you're right. A flatulist.
Yeah.
That sounds like a Yiddish word.
We'll return to that. So let's see, you know, like any scandal, the cover-up is more important than the crime.
Exactly.
So let's see what
happens. So, sorry to disappoint the... So this is a tweet from Hardball. Sorry to disappoint the conspiracy theorists. It was the Hardball mug scraping across the desk. Get yours today and let's get back to the news.
So, okay, that's a 100% indicator of guilt.
Yeah, exactly. You watch House, right? You watch the show
yes.
House. So there's an episode once where a couple... Like, they have some STI, you know, sexually transmitted infection. Used to be
right.
called disease.
An STD.
But, yeah,
yep.
no longer.
Crotch red, as he says.
Oh, is it that what it is?
Yeah.
So, and he tells them, do you remember this one? He tells them that they have it, this couple, and neither one knows. It's unclear who caused it, right?
Right. He tells them that you can catch it from being sitting on a toilet.
And then he says, and you can catch it from sitting on a toilet. And the husband in the relationship is like, that must have been what happened.
Yeah, I never knew.
And then... House, because he's a master diagnostician,
right?
In more ways than one, he says, "Okay, it's you."
Right. Yeah. Exactly.
Because you wouldn't grab onto that theory,
right?
Unless you were trying to look for an alternate explanation for the affair or the extramarital, whatever that you engaged in.
Right. Exactly. Yes. No.
So
that's
what Chris Matthews just did.
I mean, if only if you had just farted on national television would you feel the urge to rush onto Twitter and make a lighthearted
right, yeah.
joke. I don't see Swalwell doing that, you know? Did he hold a press conference about it?
No, I don't think so. Oh, well, am I dumb? They were actually totally joking. I thought they were kind of serious, but I'm being way too literal, which I can be, which is so wrong because I'm so sarcastic myself. I often don't get other people's
what,
sarcasm.
I
thought that was a legit excuse. People were responding to it as if it was.
No, it doesn't matter whether they're legitimately saying that happened or
right. Oh no, I agree. No matter what, it's obviously he was the farter.
The fact that they even responded to
of
it
course,
all means
right.
That there's,
but
there's,
did you just as another point though? Do you think that they were joking, or I thought that they were actually trying to say that that's what happened?
No, I think they're just trying to make a funny out of it.
Oh, they're making funny out of it. Okay,
make a funny
got
out
it.
Of
yeah.
it. But look, that doesn't clear the air at all. In any.
Oh, look who weighed in on it—the Reagan Battalion.
What do they say?
Nope. And then it says. So after Eric Swalwell denied responsibility for the fart on MSNBC, we asked our audio expert to review the tape. He concluded that it's definitely his and his alone. He even provided us with audio waves. I can make audio waves.
To ask the Ukrainians to help him cheat.
Why does that prove it's him, though?
An election.
Why does that prove it's him and not... That's what I don't get, is no matter what, I don't see how that proves it's him over Matthews. And I agree with you, Matt, that the quality of the fart is much more Matthewsian.
Yeah, it would be higher pitched and more focused if it were
yeah,
Swalwell.
Acute.
Yeah, it would be acute.
Yeah.
It would be edgier.
Yeah, it would be edgier, yeah. Yeah. And it would be like based on a health, like I feel like, is he an athlete or was he in the army at some point or something?
I don't know, but I think we both know what we're saying.
Yeah,
here.
I think you know, and yeah. I think we know that Fartgate, the guilty partner is indeed Chris Matthews. And wow, we really came full circle with the International Toilets Day because we went from fart thing to, some people have been saying Shartgate. I don't think that's really...
Shartgate? Is shart like an alternative word for fart?
You don't know what a shart is?
No.
Oh my God. I never thought I'd have to explain to Matt Taibbi what a shart was. Come on. Use your brain. Use your noggin. This is going to ruin your career.
Sharting.
You don't
okay. All right. Yeah. So I think I get it. Yeah.
Yeah.
What happened to you?
But Ruben, I'm in a situation here. We have to leave now.
Well, no, can we stay a couple more minutes?
But dude, no, this is serious. I just sharted.
I don't know what that means.
I tried to fart and a little shit came out. I just sharted. All right, now let's go.
Amazing, how did I not know that?
I know, I can't believe that.
I've never ever done that before.
I feel like that goes with Beavis and Butthead territory big time. They never mentioned, maybe you have to rewatch the episodes. Maybe they make a lot of shart jokes that you missed out on.
I think that was pre-sharting.
Yeah. Pre, well, not chart, not
pre-shart. I had a lot of pull my
word.
Finger, dude.
Right.
jokes. I think we need to ask for official comment.
Yeah. What are the useful idiots community? What should we call our fans?
Yeah, I don't know. Idiots?
That seems so offensive.
Yeah, I don't know.
Idiot but pack?
The only thing I would say is I hope that Matthews gets around to overtly blaming Swalwell for it.
Oh, yeah. Not just, yeah, I agree.
And then it becomes a thing.
I could totally see
I
Matthews
want it to become nasty.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we should revisit this next week.
We totally should, yeah.
All right. Well, a lot of news in the last couple of weeks for Republicans suck. Basically, I just picked out a thing where Mitt Romney gave this very ridiculous, evasive answer when he was talking about, somebody asked him about impeachment, and he said that he was not paying attention to it. And the only reason I wanted to bring this up is that we didn't talk about Pierre Delecto, and I thought it was time to talk about that.
Yeah.
So Romney became the latest celebrity to be exposed. So the story always comes out the same. Somebody is giving an interview to somebody, and they ask him or her about their Twitter habits. And the person says, yeah, you know, I'm on Twitter, and I have like another account, and every now and then I look at my, you know, a relative's page, or I'll like a sports thing or something like that. They'll give some very vague information thinking they're not going to be found out.
Right.
And immediately like 1,000 cyber sleuths go and look.
Yeah.
And figure out exactly who the person is.
Okay.
So Romney gave an interview, and he told somebody, I forget who it was, that he, you know, occasionally, like, he was lurking
right.
on the internet, and they found his page, his Twitter account, and it's his name is Pierre Delecto, and he's been calling himself Pierre Delecto, and basically what he does is he goes around the internet, and the only things he commented on, basically, he looks at people who mention him.
Right.
Right. There's almost no anything else on the Pierre Delecto account except him. And so he comes under the same tradition as, like, James Comey.
I didn't hear about this.
James Comey online is Reinhold Niebuhr.
Whoa.
And he went around the internet saying all kinds of crazy things like, what's the point of watching fully clothed beach volleyball? That was your former FBI director.
I've asked myself the same question, so...
Yeah, so Romney was he was liking tweets like, hopefully Hillary will inspire a new generation of girls to marry ambitious perverts who will pay off their embarrassment with Senate seats. And then he said something, I think, to Gingrich. You were cheating on your second wife with the woman who is now your third wife, even while impeaching Clinton for cheating on his wife. Show yourself out.
That's good. What I like about that is that Pierre Delecto
mm-hmm.
is fair. Because he goes after the Clintons, but he right. also goes after Gingrich for his hypocrisy in going after the Clintons.
That's true.
It's, you know, like there's a moral...
But he did it anonymously and with a ridiculously...
Within the context of being a coward, which he yeah. is, I like the moral kind of breath of the coward.
That's
it's kind
true.
Of a nonpartisan lens.
I just think it's so weird that when all these politicians, and, you know, we've had Carlos Danger, too. Don't forget
yeah.
about that. I mean, you know, they turn out to have these alternate identities, and they're always the stupidest
I
things
know.
In the world. Like, what are they coming up? Where are they
I'm
getting these names?
I'm disappointed that Wiener's name... I mean, when your name is already Anthony Wiener,
right.
I feel like the stakes are higher.
Yeah, you got
Carlos Danger. That's kind of like less. That's more boring than his real name.
Right. Yeah, you got to work a little harder
yeah.
for that name. I mean, I don't even know what it would be, but it would. Yeah, I'd be embarrassed to go out there with Carlos Danger.
Yeah.
Also, if you're a politician and your entire career depends upon people not noticing
right.
what you're up to on Twitter.
Yeah.
Do you want to be, it's like walking around with like a, you know, a gown and feathers on it. Like if you have a ridiculous name like Carlos
right.
Danger or Pierre Delecto, like
right.
people are going to remember
Delecto.
That.
How did he come up with that?
I don't know. Anyway, so who do you think the next person is going to be? Should we place bets on who the next person to have an alternate Twitter identity?
I don't know. Who do you think?
I mean, it'll be somebody you don't expect.
Swalwell?
That. Swalwell could be.
What if Swalwell, they found out his name was like, Fletch.
Fletch.
What's that Chevy Chase movie? Fletch?
Fletch, yes.
Maybe Fletch, something
yeah.
like that, yeah. And
Dr.
then we were...
Dr.
And,
Rosen,
and the
Rosen,
whole,
Rosen penis.
And the, is that from Fletch?
Yes.
I don't remember that.
So what do we have for Democrats
oh,
Suck?
Oh, for Democrats Suck, we have something that's not at all surprising, which is that on Tuesday, today, well, we have a double whammy. We have Obama telling Dems not to be too far left, which is Obama's gonna Obama, even though he's partially responsible for Donald Trump, I would say, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, his gal, who he barely campaigned.
I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. So, yeah, so Obama addressed some Dems and said This is still a country that is less revolutionary than it is interested in improvement. They like seeing things improved, but the average American doesn't think that we have to completely tear down the system and remake it. And I think it's important for us to not lose sight of that. My point is that even as we push the envelope and we are bold in our vision, we also have to be rooted in reality and the fact that voters, including Democratic voters and certainly persuadable independents or even moderate Republicans, are not driven by the same views that are reflected on certain, you know, left-leaning Twitter feeds or the activist wing of our party. And then he said, for those who get stressed about robust primaries, I just have to remind you that I had a very robust primary. Whoever emerges from the primary process, I work my tail off to make sure they are the next president. I cannot wait for Obama to work his tail off for Bernie Sanders, by the way.
That's going to be awesome.
So this is some warning that Obama issued at the Alliance for Democracy, Democracy Alliance.
I love this whole Obama becoming a villain
yeah.
to,
I know.
To say, centrist Democrats thing. Actually, to both wings of the Democratic Party.
Well, how so?
Well, so the kind of like... The people that he's directly criticizing are kind of
Warren
like
and, and Bernie, right?
Warren and Bernie and the kind of woke left, you know.
Right,
I mean,
right.
He's
yes.
flirted with this subject a couple
right,
of times
yeah, and
already.
Cancel culture.
Right, yeah, exactly. And then I think a lot of the sort of mainstream people in the party are resentful of him piping up and becoming an issue in a way that
right.
is not necessarily... I don't know. It's interesting. Like Bill Clinton went through the same thing where he was like this, he left office as in his party, a beloved,
right.
Sort of jovial, jocular
yeah.
figure. But when Clinton sort of reentered
yeah.
public life, a couple of election cycles later, he suddenly had this temper thing and there
yeah,
was this edge
lost
to
it.
It.
Yeah,
remember,
remember
he kept,
yeah,
yeah,
of course.
Talked,
yeah,
we
yeah,
talked
yeah.
about this.
But although he did, it was at a convention or where he spoke and everyone on Twitter like swooned over him. It was weird. He spoke at one thing and people loved it. But besides that, yeah, he just became a fundamentalist.
Right.
Maybe it's the vegan diet that made him cranky.
I mean, it's the Simpsons angry old man yelling at cloud thing, right?
Yeah.
Which is great. I mean, I think, you know, that stage of life is kind of typical of a politician.
Yeah.
You get out of office, you get cranky, you
right.
get pissed off at the next,
right.
next
or you
generation.
Go, or you go skydiving with Richard Branson.
Right. Yes. Yeah, that could happen
that's
also.
The Obama move. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Did you see a picture of Richard Branson kissing, like bending down in the street? At the Wailing Wall or in Israel, it's amazing.
No.
I love this argument from Obama that, like, he knows what's best for the American people or he knows what's electable for the American people. His fight for single payer was so toothless.
Right.
And he started off with something that was way too, like, if he would want to fight for it, he would have started off further
right.
from what he got. It's just basic politics, right, when you negotiate.
Yeah. So the only thing I would hope for Obama is that he leans into this a little more.
Like Obamaism.
He needs to gain a lot of weight. Right?
Oh, right.
Lose his hair like
he's
me.
He's not going. He's not doing that, though. He's, you know, and he looks good with his gray hair, I got to say. Obama's gray hair, I think, makes him handsomer. I mean, I think he's already handsome, but I think it's very distinguished.
Yeah, but that's, I mean, he's got to aspire to something different now. This is the part of
Oh, you're saying
his...
better to fail, better to not fail.
No, he doesn't have to look good for anybody anymore.
Michelle.
He should gain weight, just sit all day long in a bar lounge.
He should gain weight.
Pounding bugles. He should wear a velour sweatsuit. You know, wear like super comfortable jeans like all day long, like, you know, 3 days in a row, wear the same pair. I mean,
right.
that's I think a president should really, like, not only am I the most powerful man in the world, but afterwards I'm going to completely let it go and,
right.
you know,
let it rip.
And, yeah, screw everybody. And I'm going to go on Twitter and tell everybody to shut up.
Yeah. You know what really surprised me about Obama mm-hmm. was when he totally sold out Keith Ellison. Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Keith Ellison was definitely going to be the uncontested nominee for Democratic chair. And Obama injected the most. Okay. You know what, Obama, I don't want to hear anything from you about what the Democrats should do, because you were single-handedly responsible for Tom Perez becoming
right.
the DNC chair. And if you think that was a good move, that's like the Republicans probably came up with that. That's how bad a candidate that guy was. He is a charisma-free Skeletor.
Right, yeah. He does have Skeletor face.
Right? He has total Skeletor face. And so, and he's...
But is he the most Skeletor-faced celebrity in America
right
now?
Who else would be up there?
Trying to think of who else would be up there.
George Burns, kind of. I mean, he's no longer with us, but he's not that Skeletor. She just came into... He's like...
And we'll have to revisit
another thing we want to know from Useful Idiots fam.
The last thing on Obama, he's clearly determined to become kind of an issue in this race,
right?
Which is interesting because he could affect it in lots of ways if he really chose to. So this is, I think he's sort of dipping his toe in the lake of commitment.
But I think he's that. I always thought I knew Obama was bad about like drones and stuff, but I kind of thought he had this personal honor. I know that's ridiculous, but I thought he had this personal kind of like swagger and grace to him. And when he really intervened to get Tom Perez to be the DNC chair, throwing out Keith Ellison, which was a bad move because he got in the way of what was kind of an olive branch for Bernie people. And it was such a vain move because he wanted his legacy. So he took his Department of Labor secretary, who nobody knew about, and injected him into the, you know, the Democratic Party. That like really surprised me.
Yeah, I mean, he probably didn't want to be to think that his presidency resulted in basically the overthrow of the party establishment.
Right, so, right, and the burnification of the party. Right,
yeah.
And but that was like, I guess I'm being naive, but that did surprise me.
I think a lot of this also is he's Obama for all of his other qualities, and he has a lot of really interesting ones. He's a fantastic political performer.
Yeah, pretty funny.
He's got a good sense of humor. You know, disappointing on a lot of political things.
Yeah,
but he I thought was always kind of a brilliant strategist in terms of like figuring out exactly like what position to take to get the most conceivable votes. And I think his radar is a little off now.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
Which is interesting.
Because he goes skydiving with Richard Branson.
Yeah.
He doesn't know that as Amo Bernie tells us all the time, and he's right, you know, all these issues that are framed as radical or written off as radical are actually have mass support.
Right.
And healthcare, minimum wage, free college tuition.
But this is what happens to all politicians when they've been around too much and they've spent, it's been, 30 years since they've actually had to earn a living from doing anything. Like they, you know, it's like the Hillary Clinton thing when they decided, okay, well, we might as well take $130 million dollars in speeches from banks because, you know, that's not a lot of money. Like, in other words, that thought actually went through their heads.
You know what's meta about that is that Hillary, I think it was during one of these speeches that she said it was something leaked that there's a danger of us being out of touch. It's funny that, you know, if only she paid more attention to that. And there was a story at the Daily Mail, RIP my cred, where apparently Bill Clinton upset that the campaign wasn't listening to him about reaching out to the white working class, threw his cell phone in anger off of the penthouse window of his Little Rock mansion.
Wow. We should almost have a word for when Obama pops up in the campaign and decides to mess with everybody. Like, that's an interesting thing.
And I just want to do kind of like a shout out, extra Democrats suck, because I think this is a great image, a great kind of way to encapsulate everything that's wrong with, well, one of the many things that's wrong with the Dems. But as Evan Greer tweeted, wow, House Democrats are ignoring civil liberties and including a 3-month straight reauthorization of the Patriot Act with zero reform in the continuing resolution. Very cool way to resist Trump by ensuring he continues to have terrifying authoritarian surveillance powers.
Right.
And then Evan Greer included a screenshot that shows...
it's the continuing resolution. So they're taking out
the sunset.
The Patriot Act was supposed to have this. Yeah, there was supposed to be a sunset act. This is going to be voted on, which is a sneaky way of signaling that they're going to vote to reauthorize it somehow.
Because they have more important fights to lose, like the impeachment. So
exactly. They don't want to get in the way of losing one important political battle by losing another.
But this is exactly like what we always say, which is, you know, like Trump is an existential, unprecedented threat, and that's why we need to have him ratchet things up with Putin, Kim Jong Un.
Well,
Cheetah Mussolini needs more like war powers.
Right. Yeah. No. It's completely counterintuitive.
Yeah.
Like, they
choose a narrative, dudes.
They you know, all the things that we did to give presidents ridiculously, you know, broad surveillance, assassination, imprisonment authority, all these things, you know, the ability to classify things, you know, to an extraordinary degree. Suddenly, not only does nobody regret that, but they're continually reauthorizing these things, and nobody sees the contradiction in that.
Right.
Because for the obvious reason that we're in the middle of this period where everybody's supposed to love the you know, the security authorities,
right.
That they're the heroes protecting the damsel in distress that is the state, right?
So, right, yeah.
So we can't take away any of their precious powers. So it's ridiculous.
Yeah.
That's a bad look. Isn't that weird? Just really briefly. Oh no, sorry. Isn't that terrible? Just the headline alone says it. Arizona sheriff's deputy tackles 15-year-old boy with no arms and legs.
I mean, how does that happen?
I was trying not to laugh when I said that.
it's funny because it's true.
It's like a Gilbert Gottfried joke, basically.
Yeah.
Like somewhere in there.
Oh my God, there's... Oh my God, that's...
Okay, all right, I can't. So the kid knocked over a trash can, and of course, so naturally, you know, as a sworn peace officer,
really,
the first
that's
thing
what it was. He knocked over a trash can.
Yeah, he was acting up at a home. They called the cops.
Why did they call the cops? Also,
I have no idea.
The only thing that I think, a
serious note on this. Obviously, it's horrible and it's like impossible to watch. And you know,
which is what they were betting on.
What are you thinking? When you tackle a kid with no, like, how in the internet age does it not go through your head that I'm going to end up on the internet in 2 seconds? You know, that's the first thing. But the
disgusting.
The thing that's horrible about this, and I think the detail that
I like, the thing that's horrible about this up until now was just a
walk in the park.
Yeah.
You can charge anybody with disorderly conduct for anything, and this is what people should realize about how, like, street enforcement works. Like, you know, some kid shows up and he just videotapes something and they can throw a disorderly conduct charge.
Right.
It's totally in the mind of
right,
the officer.
Yeah.
And even if they're completely wrong and the case is going to get thrown out, like, they, you know, you can actually bring somebody in on that. And that's something that happens a lot. So many tickets in cities like New York. This was in Arizona though, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know who'd be proud of this though? Arpaio.
Arpaio. Well, of course. Yeah. Yeah. You gotta make sure that you're tough on crime.
Yeah.
I guess, you know, to protect the public. Anyway, what we have for Isn't That Weird?
Isn't That Weird is a, you know, I feel like this is an Isn't That Weird story, but it's also, if we could open up that, yeah, thank you very much. It's also a kind of Isn't That Heartwarming? Because honestly, I've been getting a lot of pushback from my kind of cataphobic discourse. And I do think some cats are cute. And you know what kind of cats I think are cute? Are fat cats.
Fat cats?
Chubby
okay.
animals in general and chubby cats. Yeah, but so basically, let me set up this story. So I'm just going to have to read part of the article because it's such great pun material. Big pun material. Okay. So the PR catastrophe faced by Aeroflot. Have you flown that?
Of course.
Okay. It's a Russian airline, right?
I'll wear my Aeroflot shirt
okay,
next time.
Yeah. Oh, sponsorship, Bob.
Yeah, absolutely.
The PR catastrophe faced by Aeroflot after the airline banned a man from traveling with his cat because it was too heavy continues to find new lives. Uh-huh. As memesmiths flood social media with litters of feline aviators.
I'm sorry. Wait, whoever this writer is, you should be sent to lead jail for this.
Okay.
There's a four pun minimum. Anyway, go ahead.
Yeah. The tale of Mikhail Galin and fat cat Victor charmed the world earlier this month when Galin revealed how he'd fooled Aeroflot into allowing Victor to travel with him on a flight by using a cat double to get around the Russian airline's weight restrictions. Okay. He's cute. Okay. Let's see. Galin's clever switcheroo saved Victor from traveling in the hold for 8 hours and won the hearts of people everywhere. The story has been covered by news outlets across the world. However, Aeroflot was far from impressed by the cat lover's ingenuity and subsequently stripped Galin of his airline miles and kicked him out of his loyalty program. But the move appears to have backfired spectacularly after Russians began flooding social media with memes mocking the airline and depicting Victor as a champion aviator.
I'm sorry. That story, I think Aeroflot didn't. They should have thrown him off the plane.
No,
midair.
He probably saved his with or without parachute.
without.
And I don't like cats, but you know, there's a person who put their dog in the thing up top or in storage. No,
Mitt
in the
Romney.
Thing up top. Well, Mitt Romney put his defecating dog on.
Right.
Well, it wasn't defecating then. That's probably why he.
Right.
He literally strapped Seamus, that was his name, to the top of their car. And then Seamus defecated. Do you remember when you flew this airline? Were there any fat cats around? Or
no, but the airline is Aeroflot is.
They had cigarettes allowed you to smoke until like 5 months ago, right?
But they're famously, you know how Western airlines are all about, we're gonna, you know, make you happy and
right.
comfortable, and Aeroflot's the fuck you airline. It's
right.
just like, you know, they throw you in the corner. Like, I literally once got a meal from Aeroflot that was like an old piece of chicken in a plastic bag, you know, like a Ziploc bag. They'll just throw it on a plate.
Oh my God.
It's just terrible. Like, but that was always something that was kind of part of Aeroflot's charm
right.
is like, you know, you'll go into the plane and there'll be bolts sticking out of the floor
right.
and stuff like that. So I'm totally all for the fact that they completely cracked
down on
this
person.
But
why would you tell them? Why did he? His mistake was advertising that he had
yeah,
tricked
them.
Exactly. That was stupid. Anyway, yeah. I wanted to say I do think some cats are cute. So
cats can be cute.
And a lot of people are mad at me on Twitter.
Really?
They think, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right. So a couple of things. I very rarely do this. I've actually almost never used the bully pulpit of a platform in a major media outlet to get something that I personally want,
mm-hmm.
right? But in this case, I want to use Useful Idiots a little bit. I have a private obsession with sports mascots.
Okay.
I just love all of them. I research them obsessively. And one of my favorite things in life is Crazy Crab. You ever heard of Crazy Crab?
Mm-mm.
So Crazy Crab was the mascot of the San Francisco Giants.
Crab is also in Powwow Chow Recipe.
Oh, that's right. Okay. Well,
all right. It's all coming together.
This is all
Sorry,
coming
yeah.
together.
So, yeah.
So, it's the greatest idea in the history of mascots. The San Francisco Giants decided to intentionally make a shitty mascot. Okay. So, they designed this thing. It looks like a cheeseburger with hands.
Okay.
Right? It's like this terrible looking crab. And they put this poor guy who called himself Crazy Crab, and they made a terrible theme song for it, and it was like awful. People covered their ears when they heard it. It was "Everybody Loves the Crazy Crab."
Like Cindy Emmer voice.
It was so bad that people used to pelt him with batteries. Like players
That's
used to put
awful.
Firecrackers in his face and stuff like that.
That's and abuse.
So I want to find Crazy Crab. My ambition in life is to meet Crazy Crab, and I briefly saw something on Twitter about this a couple of days ago, and I remembered that I had this T-shirt. So if Crazy Crab is out there, if the person who was Crazy Crab
right.
is out there.
Oh, it's
there,
over? He doesn't exist anymore?
He doesn't. No.
Oh, this in was fact, like a short stint?
Yeah. So in fact, there was a story. I'm not even sure if this is true or not, that after they canceled Crazy Crab, that.
It's kind of an ableist name, but.
He had the Crazy Crab suit. Here we go. Is this it?
I like that little Russian dance move he's doing, you know. What is that dance move?
It's
I love it. It's so
dance.
Cute. Yeah. He just is clicking his heels in the air.
Anyway, this person allegedly took so much abuse.
Good thing it's a padded outfit.
Allegedly that when he was fired, he contrived to have the Crazy Crab costume thrown out of a helicopter over the crowd, and little children watching it thought Crazy Crab was in the suit and died, and they cried.
Oh, no.
This is I want to know if all this is true. Like this is
well,
all
they,
like sort of secondhand.
Yeah.
So Crazy Crab, if you're out there, please contact the
I
show.
I can't believe they did Crazy Crab that way.
It's just the
That's
greatest
awful.
Idea. Why
they make him so ugly and whatever, and then retire him?
I think because
that seems cruel.
I think the storyline was that the owners hated the idea of a mascot, and instead of giving in to doing a real mascot,
right.
they decided to intentionally sabotage the mascot.
I think it's kind of cute.
I think it's hilarious. So,
so your shirt says Rehab the Crab.
I got a picture of Crazy Crab in the back. So
you have to show this shirt of Crazy. Oh, he's so cute. Rehab right. the Crab. So is this a movement to bring him back? And I like his chunky legs. His chunky little, they're like chunky little, like crab legs.
I just want Crazy Crab back. I miss Crazy Crab.
So Matt, you went on Joe Rogan this week.
I did.
Last week. Congratulations.
Yeah,
I can't believe the Katie Halper bump has moved you that far. I mean, you have been on his show before, but I'm pretty sure that was like some kind of weird like ex post facto retroactive.
Oh, of course.
Katie
yeah,
Halper
it was
show.
A bounce.
Bounce,
it was
yeah.
a bounce for
yeah,
sure.
exactly. It was like a boomerang type thing in the space time continuum. But
we talked about a lot of fun stuff, like whether or not Donald Trump was on speed. So
right.
it was fun.
Yeah, it was a great interview. And one of the things that happened is that someone mentioned that you were dropping knowledge or dropping truth and asked if you'd be willing to talk to Andrew Yang. Now, you said, you kind of underplayed it. You said that you know, we'd love to talk to him. Now, Andrew Yang and the Yang Gang, I'm talking to you. And Andrew Yang's staff, I'm talking to you also. We've reached out. We've been in communication. I know that, I think that Yang and Andrew and Matt have mutual respect for each
right.
other.
That's a good way to put it.
That. I'm going to leave it at that.
I think we have collective respect.
Collective respect. I mean, I don't know if he knows who I am, but I'm sure once he finds out, he will have a lot of... It'll probably actually surpass his respect for you.
Of course. Instantaneously.
And what gives? Why hide? We've had on Crystal Ball. Crystal Ball loves Andrew Yang. She's done a lot of great Andrew Yang.
We've had Tulsi Gabbard.
We've had Tulsi Gabbard on. We've had Bernie Sanders. NBD. So not to be whatever, but I really, I'm a little offended that
Absolutely.
You guys aren't jumping at the opportunity. And I'm a little disappointed in Yang Gang, because ever since you found this out, you should have been moving to get Andrew on the show.
It's kind of an indictment of the power of the Yang Gang.
I mean,
frankly,
yeah.
Right? I mean, like we thought that they were, you know, they were kind of a feared movement.
Yeah, fierce movement. But
right?
They're pretty neutered. They're kind of neutered.
Right.
So, yeah, and I even hashtagged them. It's true, Andrew Yang, Yang Gang, make it happen. Because Matt very diplomatically said, we've asked Andrew Yang on. We'd be glad to have him on. Useful idiots.
People should be afraid of the Yang. Like, if they cross the Yang Gang, they're going to,
yeah.
like, their faces
but you know what?
Ripped
I'm gonna,
off in the middle of the night.
I'm going to say something. The Yang Gang sucks. And it's going to be,
you're just putting it
I'm
going
to put it out there, because honestly, if I don't see a response from Yang's team, it's confirmation that the Yang Gang is a powerless, that they, you know what it's confirmation of? That Yang doesn't care about the Yang Gang.
Wow. So this is the good cut back. This is where I'm going to say, like, my partner's out of control. I'm really sorry.
Yeah.
You know, you can talk to me. Everything's fine.
Yeah.
I would be very glad to talk to engage with
I mean,
the Yang
we
Gang.
Tried. I mean, there have been multiple. I don't want to share too much dirty laundry, but there have been multiple exchanges. I don't know what else I can say, Andrew and Andrew's staff.
We just hope it'll have a happy ending. And, if he does come on the show, I'm predicting a 2% bounce within
the first
week.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I mean, I'm just going to say, if he doesn't come on the show, I will personally perform a bris. He's very anti-circumcision.
There's too many bris references in this show.
That's a circumcision for people who don't know. I wouldn't circumcise my kid, by the way, but that's neither here nor there. I don't have a kid, but I'm saying if I did have
one,
I wouldn't chop this. I don't think so. But I also let's be real. It's so not. Whenever people say the word female circumcision, it's the worst. Don't call it that. It's genital mutilation and circumcision.
Okay, I'm not even going to go there.
But Andrew, all I'm saying is that I've got some sharpening my scalpels.
This has gotten out of control.
Yeah.
So, all right.
Seriously.
So the only other housekeeping item is, should we talk about Deval Patrick? Because
the Camp
Crystal Lake situation is that nobody new has really technically dropped out, but we've essentially gained a couple of, of candidates at this point.
Deval, yeah, which you wrote about.
Yeah. So we got Deval Patrick, who is going to be an inspirational Bain Capital veteran,
right.
Since, of course, we didn't have that enough in 2012.
The Mitt Romney of
So it's the Pierre Delecto of the Democratic Party.
Right.
And then, you know, Bloomberg is technically in the race
right.
now, sort of, in a couple of states.
Yeah, and who was it pointed out? I think it was Paul Blast pointed out a piece on Bolivia that the Washington Post both criticized Evo Morales for having a basically seeking out another term while also praising Bloomberg, which
okay.
was interesting because, of course, he was also not a fan of term limits. But yeah, Matt, you open your piece. Deval Patrick, former governor of Massachusetts and newly resigned executive of Mitt Romney's private equity firm, Bain Capital, has entered the Democratic primary race, which is shaping up to be the biggest ensemble disaster comedy since Cannonball Run. And so then you had someone on Twitter respond.
Yeah, so someone suggested that we should come up with, we should try to figure out for every character in Cannonball Run, assign everyone who's in the Democratic Party race to one of those characters.
Right.
So we have to figure out who is the Dom DeLuise in the story,
yeah.
and who's the Burt Reynolds in the story, who's the Farrah Fawcett in the story. A lot of amazing cast members in this.
I've never seen that movie.
Who's the Captain? Oh, you haven't seen
What's
Cannonball Run? Cannonball Run, if you hadn't seen it, is one of the greatest bad movies of all time. It made $100 million, I think, wow. in 1981. The script is completely mailed in. Like, they stopped trying in within the first 5 minutes, but it's just hilarious. They had everybody in the world in the movie.
Yeah, it's
and
huge.
It's like Smokey and the Bandit meets The Great Race meets something. I don't know what it is, but it's just like the Democratic Party primary. It had way too many characters in it, and it was incredibly
right.
hard to follow. And
so
you didn't really
ensemble.
Believe any
yeah.
of the acting. So
right.
it's perfect. I think that's a project that's worthy.
So very excited to talk with our guest, a former subject of the show, now becoming guest of the show, Max Blumenthal. He's an award-winning journalist and the author of several books, including best-selling Republican Gomorrah, Goliath, The 51-Day War, and The Management of Savagery. He's produced print articles for an array of publications, many video reports, and several documentaries, including Killing Gaza. Blumenthal founded The Gray Zone in 2015 to shine a journalistic light on America's state of perpetual war and its dangerous domestic repercussions. And he's the co-host of Moderate Rebels with Ben Norton. And his website, Gray Zone, uses a very serif-heavy font.
Right. Yes, it does.
And let's welcome Max. Let's welcome him on.
The studio audience that we don't have.
Welcome, Max Blumenthal. So excited to have you on.
Welcome.
Good to be on. Good to be in this white Elysium cloud.
Yeah. Welcome to the cloud. Max, as we already have mentioned, Max is a great and very controversial journalist and the founding editor of The Gray Zone, which is really important work. And Max is also Armed and Dangerous, apparently. We'll get to that shortly. But we actually did talk about Max. We talked about you a couple episodes ago when you were arrested.
Thank you for doing that.
Yeah, sure. We were like one of, I mean, this, I'm not damning us with faint praise here, but we were one of like five places, I think, that talked about it.
Well, you were the most kind of mainstream.
I mean, it's pretty
mainstream
big,
adjacent.
Yeah, exactly.
Mainstream
yeah.
adjacent.
Yeah. But it was ridiculous. So we'll get into that, and I definitely want to get into the like silence around that, which was
the first thing I want to ask about is this picture.
Yeah, the Twitter picture.
Yeah.
What's up with your Twitter?
I saw that photo in an RT piece about my arrest, and I was really amused by it. I kind of look like a jet-lagged kind of Bond wannabe.
Yeah.
And
half villain, half actual Bond. It's
well,
kind of a
but
mix.
You can actually see there's an RT like. Bat like logo around my lanyard because I was at the RT 10th anniversary, which was this notorious thing that I just went to for the spectacle of it. And you know, no one knew who Michael Flynn was, and I was hanging out with Jill Stein and was thinking like this might be problematic for her, but
right.
like I don't care. You know, I'd been
oh, so you were there.
That's so I was there, and so now there's like this constant attack on me, you know, saying that I was recruited by Putin and
right.
grew there to be like a Russian spy/asset, and I thought, you know, it's kind of a protest photo to just kind of say fuck you to everyone.
Right. to say hello, Russia.
Yeah.
How do you say hello?
Hello, Russia, are you listening?
Oh. Yeah.
Basically, what it says is that all roads lead to Putin.
Right.
That's right, as Pelosi says. I want to ask about the decision. So you chose the folded fingers pose.
Chose that of me.
As right. opposed to the...
As opposed to holding, what is the animal that
the
you're
cat,
kissing?
The fluffy cat.
Yeah,
fluffy
he
cat.
Definitely looks like you look like, I have to say, because I've had Max on my
Dr.
show a
no?
bunch.
I have some really embarrassing author for yeah. photos out there. I mean, there's like...
Oh, wow.
Oh
you just
God,
got
yeah,
burned.
Those
Thank
terrible,
you, film
yeah.
crew, for
That's
pulling
a good,
up,
it's a decent photo.
It is a good photo, but you know what? You kind of
there's
look
a
like
worse
Adam
one. I'm
Johnson
not gonna, yeah.
when his Jack Black type of photo, where it's like this, it's this kind of very like... Cheers. Like
yeah, no,
a little bit of a raised eyebrow.
Yeah,
and,
no, yeah, no. There's the one that you would see the one with the hand. That's the
oh,
really
wait, where's
bad
the
one.
Hand one? Let's see.
See
oh, my God.
There?
It's
this
very
is like a
flattering, but ridiculous.
SI swimsuit
yeah.
issue picture.
Matt's hand is behind his head. It's almost like he's doing crunch, like... How would you describe this?
You're no, like a self-help author for like suburban men.
I think it's more like female
no,
model.
The way
yeah,
of the
no,
superior
it's
man
it's
dealing with dating and aging and...
It's a come hither gigolo photo. Yeah,
yeah
it's really bad.
He has his hand behind
it's really
his
bad.
Head. That's not
that's
like
a good
that.
Photo.
That. Yeah, but that's just a whatchamacallit. Yeah, it's very endearing.
Stelter.
Not that does not look like you.
Yeah.
But
that's from the Huffington Post game. That was stuck
you're
behind.
A game changer.
I was a game changer. I was behind Michael
leader.
Bloomberg at that one.
Yeah. Wow. Just behind Michael Bloomberg.
Wait, why are we talking about me?
Wait, we'll go back.
Yeah, can
on.
You mock me?
Yeah,
this is moving on. Anyway.
Well, one of the problems with me is that I don't have eyebrows.
Oh, yeah.
And so I just look
you photograph
kind of like
weird.
A serial killer in every photo,
yeah.
no matter what.
Or Whoopi Goldberg.
Come on now.
She doesn't have eyebrows. Have you noticed that? But it's
Whoopi Goldberg doesn't have eyebrows.
Now that I brought it up, you're
yeah, but she isn't like
it.
She doesn't blend into this wall behind
right,
me.
Right.
Like I just look like two.
You need to just
eyes.
why don't you tattoo them?
Yeah, like microdermabrasion or like.
We could probably superimpose some eyebrows
yeah.
on.
I have to say, as someone who's had Max on my show and I like to make graphics with when I have people on. Actually, you both were in my Anchorman photo that I did on a Russiagate episode.
Oh, right, yes.
I superimposed uh-huh. your faces onto various Anchorman characters. You guys, Glenn Greenwald, Rania Kallik. And it's very hard to find a flatter. You're a handsome man in real life.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome. But it's hard to find a flattering photo of you. You don't photograph well. That's not an insult, by the way, saying someone's photogenic or not photogenic. It's not an insult. It just means how much the camera represents how you look in real life. Sometimes people
there's just a thing about me where I don't look. I just look like a little bit like, I don't know, maybe unique is a certain word. So wherever I go, somebody always says I look like some character in some show. It's either this guy in Homeland. Someone said I look like some guy in Grey's Anatomy. Growing up in D.C., I got compared to either Steve from 90210 or Michael Rapaport.
Michael Rapaport, that's the one I see the most.
A little bit of Carson Wentz in there, too.
Who's that?
He's a football player.
Carson Wentz?
Yeah.
Well,
but that's a nice.
I have a better offensive line right now.
yeah, you do. Many offensive lines.
He's getting hit.
Anyway, so, but that is a flattering photo of you. There's another good photo of you, but it's a little blurry. I've known this because I tried it, you know, when
you
I
looked
made
up
it.
Prince Harry. Prince Harry came up.
Yeah, Prince Harry. We should.
Oh, because you're a redhead.
Yeah, so actually, that's.
I wonder if that came up.
Hang on.
Are we going to talk about anything here on
no,
the show?
We're just look
this is like Seinfeld where nothing happens.
We're funny.
The celebrity math is Prince Harry times Damian Lewis divided
Damian
by
Lewis.
Carson Wentz.
Yeah, that's. I mean, that gives you max.
I think that's it.
Max Blumenthal.
Right. All right. So you got arrested recently.
Yeah. You want to start off with that?
Tell us about that.
Yeah. Again, thank you for bringing that to your viewers and listeners' attention. There actually has been a real strong outpouring of support. I've gotten a lot of solidarity that I didn't expect to get, including from some people who just will never promote one of my articles or whatever, which is great because there's a principle there that should be upheld. There's also been people who celebrated me being arrested and basically confirmed that they want me jailed because they don't like what I have to say.
It's never a good look. You're supposed to pretend if you believe in democracy and they call you like a genocide celebrator, denier, they're supposed to pretend to be opposed to jailing people for their words.
Backing up, let's set the scene. No. What happened?
Well, I was in and around the Venezuelan embassy when Juan Guaido's mafia in Washington, which is basically paid, is paid by the U.S. government, led by this figure, Carlos Vecchio, who's the fake ambassador in Washington. These are people who've been plotting coups in Venezuela for almost two decades now, wanted to take over the Venezuelan embassy in Washington and turn it into their own lobbying shop in complete violation of the Vienna Conventions, in violation of D.C. eviction law. And a number of activists and journalists mobilized to kind of get in their way and defend international law. I was among them. And at the Gray Zone, we've been exposing the coup and ripping the opposition Guaido narrative to absolute shreds. So the opposition eventually laid siege, taking their kind of right-wing exile community in Northern Virginia and around the country and surrounding the embassy to starve out those activists who were inside. I was outside. And anyway, 5 months after this standoff ended, it ended with a military Waco-style raid on the embassy to extricate the four final embassy defenders who now are facing a year in prison for being there. 5 months after that, a team of D.C. police officers show up at my door pretty aggressively, threatening to break my door down. It's Friday morning. It's 9 a.m. And you
had no indication that anything like this was coming?
I had no indication that there was any warrant for me, and I hadn't done anything that could have been remotely considered criminal. What I can say, because it's an open case, is that the charge against me is simple assault. I'm completely innocent. I'm just, it's a complete fabrication. And it was made against me, I believe, because of who I am and the work that I do, by a group that's being basically used by the U.S. government to carry out a vicious coup against an independent country and its U.N. recognized elected government. And beyond that, when the police arrived, they demanded to come into my house. I didn't know it at the time, but I was listed as armed and dangerous in the warrant. So essentially what this U.S.-backed opposition movement was doing was using the cops, essentially weaponizing the cops, in effect swatting me as to get revenge on me. And the police...
Well, okay. Well, you don't know 100% right. that's exactly what happened, right? I mean, you don't know exactly what the genesis of your case is. I mean,
well, it stems from a false allegation by an opposition member.
That's okay. That's true. Yes.
And a decision that was made.
You know who the person, I'm not trying to, but you know who the person is.
Yes.
Okay. And it's an opposition person. Okay. Yeah.
Yes. And it's someone I never assaulted.
Right. And you're like, I went through all my assaults. It did not include.
But it's part
person.
Of a wider strategy used. For example, police recently showed up at Medea Benjamin's house on a false assault charge, leveled against her by the same exact element, U.S.-backed element in D.C. So there's a pattern there.
And they said she assaulted Debbie Wasserman Schultz. But then they didn't arrest her.
Interrupting.
Let's play, like, not devil's advocate, but just saying things that are, like, to the most anti-Max Blumenthal, most cynical person, right? Here's what you know, right? You were picked up at your house 5 months after the alleged
incident.
You had no idea about that. You were taken to the...
Well, they threatened to break my door down, my home. There were many of them, apparently because I'm armed and dangerous, right, according to this warrant.
Yeah, how does that designation even happen?
It happens on 3% of warrants, according to the National Crime Information Center, and it's usually for people who have a history of homicide or who are on the run for a violent crime.
Okay.
So I don't know how that happened. Thrown in a paddy wagon.
I mean, is it like a check in a warrant, or is it something that's actually written somewhere?
It was that they have various designations of the wanted person, and they checked armed and dangerous.
Right. Okay.
And I tweeted it out from the warrant. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I'm thrown in a paddy wagon. They're like, we're just trying to get you to court. We'll have you out today, though that didn't happen. And I wasn't, after driving around my neighborhood, picking up various people for the crime of being poor. They take me to the local police station, deny everyone a right to call their lawyer.
Oh, so
or
everyone was denied that right.
This is just routine, and nobody says anything about it because these are poor black people who are denied the right to call
anyone. Right, so it doesn't get any.
They don't have a voice. Right, they're just totally voiceless. And then,
I thought they were picking on you, but this is just that's just what they do.
Yeah.
Right. Wow. Do you feel better now knowing that it wasn't personal, and that everyone is disenfranchised and has their rights violated?
I feel more connected to them.
I was kidding, but yeah.
I live in Ward 8 in D.C., and I know what goes on there, and, I know guys who have to wear ankle bracelets, and they themselves hadn't even done anything that merited that, but to actually, go through the process they go through week in and week out, where then I was thrown in a cell with a guy. It's a 5x7 cell with just a little toilet there, and I just have to languish there for 15 or 16 hours with nothing to do. Then you're taken and transferred to where the court. There's U.S. Marshals there. They're super aggressive. This is your, get against the wall. This is your groin check. Do not react. There's all different forms of shackling. You're put in what's called the bullpen. And, it's 60 or 70, almost all black men chained or, they were cuffed and they're now being held in a cage. It's very similar to the images of migrant children on the border. Mm. Then you're transferred. Oh, well, then at a certain point, the mentally ill were brought into the bullpen. So you have people who can barely function in society, right, who are just thrown in the middle
really
of this cage with you.
Yeah.
And that, you know, agitates the environment, whereas everybody was kind of getting along and, you know, there's a boredom, so everyone's talking to each other. Then you're transferred to, after, you know, more shackling, where now your hands and your feet are shackled, you're transferred to a smaller cage with 10 guys in separate cages right behind the court. And then I had to wait, basically. I was the first person in and one of the last people out. And, you know, by the time I got before the judge, I had like cuts in the back of my ankles. And, you know, at one point I couldn't get off the floor because I kind of like tried to sit down, and, you know, it's impossible to get off the floor when you're shackled like that. So, you know, it was a physically sort of exhausting process just to get before the judge, and they let me go on my own recognizance. And now I have a status hearing on Friday where a trial date will be set by the federal government, by the Trump Department of Justice. And it appears that they're going to take this to trial and attempt to convict me on this false charge.
And you could get, you know, in the worst case scenario, which is probably not likely, but it could happen, you could actually get some time, right?
Well, first of all, simple assault is a misdemeanor charge. And a number of guys I was in jail with went home without charges. They call it no paper, the golden ticket. They had simple assault charges. The corrections officer said, yeah, simple assault's always thrown out. Don't worry about it, man. Look at what's happening. It's a political case. And so I've had to shell out for a trial lawyer and prepare myself, prepare to acquit myself and to establish that I am indeed innocent. So the facts are going to speak for themselves if the government wants to take this sham to trial. But what's pertinent here is that this is part of a wider campaign to not only use, you know, the media and social media to denigrate and defame and essentially destroy me and everyone around me. It is part of a wider campaign to use the legal system against me and the gray zone, and more details will be coming out about that. This is sort of the wave of the future.
Well, let's get into that a little bit, because there's a couple of things here. First of all, clearly, because of the time frame, somebody had to make a decision considerably after the fact, consciously, to do this. And, you know, I think the police, generally speaking, if there's a journalist involved especially, they're, you know, it's not like this is something that happens on the spur of the moment. They actually have to think this through most of the time. So it's a very bizarre thing. I mean, is your attorney going to try to find out through discovery how this all came about, whose idea it was? I mean, was the complaint filed very late? I mean, what's the explanation for it?
I was told by someone who had knowledge of the process that a judge had rejected a warrant for me months ago. You know, I traveled in and out of the country during this period of 5 months, and customs didn't stop me. Nothing happened. They knew where I was. So first of all, they could have just called me and said, turn yourself in. There was no reason. I was a flight risk and I have nothing to fear because I'm innocent. But instead they chose this very aggressive method of picking me up. And then beyond that, you raised a really important question. Why did this happen? And how can we learn about this decision? So there are going to be, as far as I know, I hope there will be attempts at discovery. But what the State Department can do is put protective orders on discovery so that I'm unable to publicly reveal it.
Right.
To reveal collusion. But as I said before,
collusion.
Yes.
Finally going to prove collusion.
Collusion between the Venezuelan opposition, whose salaries, I mean, this is a group that was basically created by the U.S. They're called Voluntad Popular, or Popular Will, in Venezuela. And they've been behind every coup against Hugo Chavez and Nicolas Maduro.
I mean, do you think this falls kind of under the rubric of using the criminal justice system to kind of freak out journalists or even actively punish? There's been more of that in the last, you know, 15 years or so since the war on terror started. You know, you have the various instances of the Espionage Act being invoked, right, with people, who national security sources who talk to reporters. There was I think it was a Fox reporter who was an unnamed co-conspirator in one of the Espionage Act cases. So the idea of, like, charging reporters with crimes,
Assange, obviously.
The Assange thing. I mean, do you think this is an individual instance of maybe somebody doing a favor for somebody in the Venezuelan, you know, diaspora movement or what do you want?
Yeah, I can say conclusively that the U.S.-backed Venezuelan opposition made a decision to lie about me and to take steps to have me imprisoned and prosecuted. And and we also know that the U.S. government is responsible for the existence of their political party in Venezuela and its apparatus in Washington and Miami. So that's what I can say for sure. Mm-hmm. And we need to learn more, but there is a wider campaign against me and the gray zone using the media and the legal system. And I think, you know, first of all, I've always said that, you know, I could get the Washington Post to write about this really pertinent Washington story if I were to take up Russian citizenship and denounce Putin.
Right.
Right.
But, you know, you lived in Russia. I mean, you lived in a much less open society. You know, maybe you have more of a perspective on what journalists go through where it's unclear how you're going to run up against the legal system.
Oh, yeah. Well, yeah. Or they just get hit in the head with a crowbar over there. You know? I mean, we're not there yet.
But I think we're moving into that realm.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe, you know, a Turkey scenario. But we've definitely entered an information war where this is no longer about journalism. It's about an information war, and the intelligence community and the national security state are setting the agenda. And if you want to make it in journalism, you have to go along with that agenda. And, you know, the more enthusiastic you are to advance it, to be an asset, as it were, or a useful idiot of the CIA, the better you're going to do and the more awards you're going to get from these kind of billionaire-funded journalism awards societies, which have, you know, where billionaires kind of function as cutouts of the national security state. So that's the era we're in journalism. And
I mean, especially in Washington, where the paper of record in the city is, you know, owned by a major CIA contractor. And
yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
It's, you know, it's gotten kind of silly. I mean, almost every day you open up the Washington Post, there's a story that has four unnamed people familiar with the matter who are leaking X, Y, and Z. And it's just a steady drip of information that's coming from the same place. And,
yeah.
And you know, it's gotten embarrassing.
So, I mean, I see this because of the information war, there's still a public that's desperate for a more democratic, open discussion about what the U.S. is doing in the world and what's happening in Washington, how the sausage is made. And people are turning to you and turning to us. And that frustrates the other side to the point where they're taking measures to just simply wipe us out. And they're not going to be, you know, satisfied with us having even a podcast.
Something that both of you have written about is the way that, you know, Trump, and I'm so tired of having to make these disclaimers about how, like, you and both of you or whoever I'm defending or having on the show or reading or tweeting about in a positive way, that they don't like Trump. So there's no, you don't like Trump. You're not big Trump fans. You're not big Putin fans. But you also see how you see things beyond like individual personalities, and your politics isn't based on like this hagiography. But talk about, to quote Amy Goodman, talk about the way people think that there are a lot of people who really think that there should be some kind of intelligence community overthrow or some kind of coup or some kind of removal of Donald Trump.
Or they'll say whatever they're doing is appropriate.
Or whatever it takes, kind of. Yeah, or whatever they're doing is appropriate, right? What is this thing that's worse than Trump that's out there, which you can't even say, because if you say that, you're accused of being a Trump supporter or Trump fan. But your piece about, like, how coups aren't good.
Right, yeah.
Was, like, considered heresy.
Well, I think Max, you know, you were saying that on election day in 2016.
Talk about your prediction.
And what you said that night.
Yeah, it was an unusual night. I don't think this is about, you know, who's better, Trump or the IC.
Right.
Or the CIA, although...
What's the IC?
The intelligence community. You know, they're like a Mensa group that goes in the woods and just consults an intelligence oracle.
It's like an Iron John meeting.
They bang drums and tell us what's going to happen next with the...
Hugging.
What do they always say on their reports? Like a high confidence?
Yeah.
We're not sure, but there's a high confidence.
There's high confidence medium confidence in the case of the NSA.
We consulted the oracle at our Iron John sweat lodge, and John Brennan has high confidence that... Yeah, that Tulsi Gabbard's an asset. No, on election night, you know, I did not want Donald Trump to win. I live in D.C., okay? There's no, it goes 85% Democrat. It doesn't matter who I vote for. So I wrote in Jeremy Corbyn and Chapo Guzman. I mean, I was not going to vote for Hillary Clinton. She is a very dangerous person on the world stage, as we've seen with Libya, Syria, sure. Honduras. Horrible situation. We've written about it, the gray zone. Anyway, but you know, everyone knows my parents are supporters of Hillary Clinton. My father has a relationship with her. Me and my father have a great relationship. I get along very well with
Sydney
my parents.
Blumenthal.
Yeah, and we agree on a lot of things, and we don't agree on Hillary Clinton. You know, people don't always agree with their boomer parents.
Happy Thanksgiving. I mean, yeah,
it's not a big deal. But I was hanging out at their victory party, and you know, it started to turn kind of grim. And then
Ryan Grimm showed up. Ba-dum-bum.
He wasn't there, but. He just showed up at my father's book party. He has a new book out about Lincoln. So.
Oh, really? Let's have Sid on.
Yeah, you should. I'll set it up.
Yeah. We should have both you and Sidney on. It could be this.
Sorry,
just moving my mug. Did you see Fartgate?
We'll get into that later. Okay. Anyway, go.
We could have you on and be like, what was it? Rich son, poor son? No, rich dad, poor son.
Rich dad, poor dad. I went on Air America with him once, like a million years ago.
Lib dad, left son?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, whatever. It was the Bush era, and we were all just against the Republicans.
Yeah, I know. Isn't it embarrassing? Like, when you look back,
remember,
like,
I used to go on Rachel Maddow's Air America show all the time. I'm like, she's really smart. Yeah. You know?
I remember meeting her once, and I was saying how much I like, this was, you know, when Bush was president, and I said how much I like that Stephen Colbert called out, as a Catholic, called out, like, the incoherence of homophobia in the Bible. And was basically, I don't know, he made some point about how, like, well, the Bible also says that there should be adult circumcision, and the barn door's kind of closed on that.
It's too much circumcision talk in this episode.
In fact, we haven't, well, for this, we're below our quota.
Right, yeah.
Below the cutoff, if you will. And I remember Rachel Maddow was like, I don't like politics through biography. And I remember being like, she's smart, but this is a dumb point. Anyway, back to what we were saying. It was election night.
Anyway, yeah. So I'm, you know, at the Hillary party turns grim. I got a call from my friends.
Would you have voted for Hillary in a swing state, by the way? Because you brought up how you voted for.
At that time, you know, I probably wouldn't have made such a glib decision. But, you know, it's like choosing between lupus and cancer. It's tough.
Lupus, probably.
Yeah, I just wonder big war Hillary would have started by now. At the same time, she wouldn't have done Trump's $1 trillion tax cut.
Right.
And that's, you know, my issue with Trump is that he's just a representative of the oligarchy.
Right.
Without any, you know, doesn't have the democratic kind of slow motion oligarchy process.
But farm to table.
So back to election night, I leave because Sam Sachs and Sam Knight, who now have the show District Sentinel, which I think is a DSA show. At the time, they were at Sputnik Radio, which has some good lefty shows. Yeah. And I went in, they said, you want to talk about the election? And I went in and it was basically Florida had just gone for Trump. And I said, Donald Trump is going to be targeted with a deep state intelligence coup. And Sam Sachs was like, what the hell are you talking about? I think he just, you know, he was like, why are you kind of painting Trump as a kind of a victim here?
Right.
I'm like, I don't like Trump. I don't identify him. But it was obvious what was going to happen next. And in fact, this neocon, Jamie Kirchick, had written in the LA Times that the intelligence community should mount a coup against Trump. Where was he getting that from? It's like he's getting that through osmosis from the political atmosphere that he exists in, this little neocon hothouse.
Sort of a trial balloon. Yeah.
Yeah, trial balloon. Good point. And so obviously it happened with Russiagate erupting almost a few days after Trump getting elected. And also Hillary Clinton's first public statement. We can't forget what that was. Fake news, the scourge of fake news, which is basically setting the stage for social media censorship.
Which is so weird because none of the major stories that came out that summer were really fake news. They were all real news. There were leaks of real. Anyway, go ahead.
So what I saw with the Women's March, you know, my mother went to the Women's March and was protesting Trump's policies on women's reproductive rights. And I'm like, that's totally legitimate. Like, that's what she's always been involved in, you know, campaigning for women's reproductive rights. But I saw these other people carrying these bizarre Russiagate signs. And Trump's always gay with Putin. Putin.
Yeah, it's so ridiculous.
It's like,
ridiculous.
Not only is he with Putin, but being gay is bad.
Right, I know. All these woke people all of a sudden like gay jokes.
Well, if you look closely at those posters, it's a pregnant Trump with Putin basically being the pitcher and Trump's the catcher, which means that our empire is being weakened by this more masculine Russian.
Right, he's the top.
And Trump is a woman.
Right.
So it's also kind of like, sexist, but also imperialist. Like, it's imperialist paranoia.
Wasn't there a version of that with Honecker and Gorbachev once upon a time?
Honecker sounds like Bernie Sanders pronouncing Hanukkah.
They sell it at the Berlin Wall, the poster of them making out.
Right.
That's a good, that reminds me of that in a lot of ways, but it's much more explicit.
Yeah, this is much more,
So I couldn't get into the resistance at that point. It's like, what is the resistance? Is this really a resistance against Trump? Where they, it first started out with the Muslim ban and, going to airports. But it was co-opted and hijacked by what I think was essentially taking the lessons and the tactics of color revolutions in Eastern Europe and Latin America that these disinformation warriors and intelligence veterans had employed, and bringing it back home against Donald Trump, and then setting the stage for an intelligence coup, which we're still witnessing through the impeachment hearings. I mean, you just look at the testimony of people like George Kent, who says that, America's traditional foreign policy should be about turning countries like Ukraine into NATO states at Russia's doorstep, and essentially having not just a Cold War with Russia, but possibly a hot war. And he said, this is what we've done for 70 years. Well, I don't agree with that. That's really dangerous. Right. But the point is, these people aren't elected.
The moment for me that was most amazing for that was the examination of Vindman.
Yeah.
And the first questioner, I think it was Goldman, right, is saying he's asking Vindman, like, first he describes what the consensus was, the national security consensus, and then Vindman says, we began to be aware of outside influencers who were undermining the uniform policy. Where did this language come from? Right. The uniform policy? Like, what the fuck is that?
As in what they were supposed to wear?
Uniforms.
Well, there are people in Ukraine who wear Nazi uniforms.
Oh, my God.
The Azov Battalion. Yeah. And George Kent, in his testimony, likened them to the American Minutemen. But, he didn't mean the Minutemen were fighting for slavery.
Not the recent ones, but the old ones. Not the,
the old ones who were also fighting for.
Sure, of course.
Nazi Minutemen.
Yeah, right, yeah.
But that's not what he meant. These Nazis are American heroes and we should arm them.
No one has a problem with with Trump. This is what's so great. And it's like the whole thing about the impeachment is Trump putting a hold, on the security to arm Ukraine, right? And no one's upset about that.
No, in fact, that's constantly portrayed as Trump was withholding the vitally necessary military aid. Javelin missiles to Ukraine. Like, why the hell is that in our national interest?
I interviewed Aaron Maté about this for my show, and he was just saying how pathetic it is that Donald Trump, what he did was he put a temporary pause on Obama's he basically for a moment adopted Obama's policies, right? Because Obama actually decided not to green light selling weapons to Ukraine because he didn't want to fuel this proxy war.
Yeah.
And no one is talking about that and how maybe we don't want to arm Ukraine. That's not the issue at all. It's anything that you can find to nab Trump. And of course, the irony is that it's never something that actually has a strong moral case, and it's never something that will reach the unmotivated base or the Obama to Trump potential anti-Trump voters. Right? Somehow the Democrats managed to focus on the entirely wrong things.
Yeah.
They were so painful and boring. And we knew this would happen. We knew that Trump wouldn't be humiliated by these impeachment hearings, and that everyone who says he would be are the same people who constantly say the walls are closing in on him. And I'm so tired of being called like a Trumpian or a Trump apologist for just having
Trump
a view that's
the
actually
left,
the Trump and left, that for having a view that's actually much more effectively anti-Trump, or a plan that's much more effectively anti-Trump than the people who define themselves and live and breathe as anti-Trump but provide no actual resistance.
So before I get to the ultimate point I wanted to make related to election night, that is such an important point, because what these impeachment hearings and Russiagate has done is it's reduced the American public, and specifically the most progressive sectors of it, to spectators.
Yeah.
And so when we have anti-war rallies in Washington, it's only, you know, the people who are able to see through this and who are veteran,
right,
you know, anti-war activists. You have to ask, why in a country where austerity is not only spun out against the rest of the world, but where it's impacted such a large percentage of the population, where we are officially an oligarchy, why we don't see the kind of movements that we see now in Chile, in Haiti, in Ecuador, where they're actually forcing the hands of their government and forcing them to actually roll back some of these brutal austerity policies against the masses of people who are just workers. Why is that? Part of it has to do with the fact that this fake resistance has actually supplanted the real resistance we need, because they're funded by and controlled by the rich and supported and, you know, interact with our intelligence community. The CIA's goal around the world is basically to clear space for international finance.
Right.
So that's the tragedy that we're dealing with right now. And I don't know how we're going to recover from it. But what I saw that on election night, sitting there with Sam and Sam, was this depressing scenario. And I decided that if there is a choice between Trump and a literal intelligence coup, where the intelligence, the FBI, and all of its cutouts and the CIA gets to determine who our leadership is, you have to go with the elected leader, even if it's elected through the shitty electoral system. You have to just stand on a democratic principle. And the people who attack you for being in the Trump and left, they're anti-democratic.
Right.
They don't respect civilian authority. And so I kind of, in a way, appreciate the Trump era for bringing out that contradiction.
Well, I mean, I always thought that was one of the amazing things about 2016. Like, you know, I'd covered presidential elections dating back to 2004. And for me, the story was always incredibly depressing in the sense that it was totally predictable. The whole idea was to narrow the choices of the electorate down to a little tiny stripe where they got to choose between this and that, and they could never break out of it. And you saw that voters were getting extremely depressed by this over time. Trump, for all of his flaws, represented a complete departure from that whole system, right? Like he was outside of that. Now I think they made a terrible choice, but it wasn't a choice that was within like an accepted framework, right? So it in a way, it was an affirmation of democracy in this crazy way.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And he was reaching people directly through TV shows, through reality TV,
and Twitter.
Very similar to Vladimir Zelensky in Ukraine, who is the only person in that country possible of making peace in a proxy war where the U.S. is just treating Ukrainians like bullet stoppers and devastating people in eastern Ukraine. Only someone like that could start this peace process, and he's facing a similar attack, but it's from the far right. As well as the kind of NGO apparatus the U.S. has set up to prevent that peace process. That's partly what these Ukraine gate hearings are about as well. There's always an echo of foreign policy in all of these domestic spectacles, anti-Trump spectacles. And Bernie Sanders has actually demonstrated much more spine on foreign policy in this primary campaign. He's being kind of ignored because I think,
He came right out and said the thing was a coup and believe
yeah,
that, right?
Yeah, amazing.
Well, first he said it looked like a coup, then he said it is a coup, yeah.
And
I'm like the last person. Yes, he was far. Then we got to talk about Elizabeth Warren.
His staff is really on point.
They are, yeah.
He's playing to win this time. And I think that if he somehow gets the nomination, I don't know what the path forward is, but he's obviously the only candidate as an actual movement behind him.
Right.
We're going to see the same campaign run against him that's been run against Jeremy Corbyn.
Yeah.
And everyone watching this now, you can read A Very British Coup by Chris Mullins, or go on YouTube and watch the British film made about it for free. And it will tell you it's the game plan for what's being used against Jeremy Corbyn. But it was a fictional kind of science fiction book in the late 70s written in the UK about a socialist prime minister coming to power, nationalizing industry with massive public support, ending the kind of trident nuclear system in Scotland and rolling back, you know, British neo-imperialism, and he comes under attack from an MI5 coup spun out through the media. And that's exactly what's happening with Corbyn. It is exactly what's happening with Bernie. What will happen with Bernie, but for now the strategy is to ignore him until they can piece together a narrative, and it will be run by many of the same elements that have run this campaign against an odious figure in Donald Trump.
Yeah, the Bernie campaign, it kind of reminds me, I remember the movie Eric the Viking? It was like a Monty Python movie.
I was never a Monty Python fan.
It was from the guys from Monty Python. There was like a kingdom at the end where like they're on an island and literally like the water rises and sinks the entire island. And they're like, to the very last, they're saying, this isn't happening. Where we were like, they're just pretending it's not happening, literally as they're falling underwater. And that's the Sanders campaign. It's amazing to watch. He's like extracted from the headlines.
Yeah,
it's like it's
their
not
math
being covered.
Is off. I mean, they literally just get the math wrong when they're covering him. He's not. Yeah, it's like that famous Stalin image with the person.
Trotsky cut out. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, that's,
I see. You know, so much of our you know the color revolutions and the regime change operations in American contemporary political campaigns and. Pete Buttigieg reminds me kind of like Juan Guaido or this woman Jeanine Añez in Bolivia,
who
she won 4.5% of the vote in order to get elected, and now she's sort of self-declared president. Juan Guaido became president of the National Assembly, getting elected with very few votes in one of the least populous states in Venezuela. And Pete Buttigieg, I think, won 8,500 votes to be elected mayor of South Bend and actually lost all of the black districts in the Democratic primary. And now he's like polling at the top in Iowa. He's just being pushed to the top.
And the media has
has he done to earn that?
Well, the media decided he was surging, and they kept saying it, and they keep saying it. And then you have people who hear it who aren't bad people, per se, although I don't understand people who get excited by him, because I don't know what they're excited by, except for his woodchuck, je ne sais quoi, which we've talked about. But anyway.
Yeah, he doesn't even have, big structural Bailey.
No, he has big structural teeth, though. But Yeah, it's like they keep saying he's surging, and then you have good-natured people who don't really understand it, and they hear it, and then they think he's a viable candidate.
So I have a theory that why this is why this is great news for you, and maybe all of us. But if Buttigieg wins in Iowa, that's great for Bernie Sanders.
Oh, really?
Because if he wins in Iowa, he can't win in South Carolina.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. Especially because he just created some phantom black voters. But we'll talk about that in a second.
He's polling at zero with black voters in Iowa. So
there are zero black voters in Iowa.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. In South Carolina.
Yeah.
He's polling at zero. So if Buttigieg wins Iowa, then the Democratic vote is going to be fractured because he can't win in one of the next key states. So it's going to be the same situation that happened with Trump. The person who has a consistent big base of support in every state is going to be the one that's going to be likely to win, and that would be Bernie in that situation. So if it ends up being split between Buttigieg, Warren, and Biden, you know, if it's four people, Bernie would have the clearest path.
So should we start doing like campaign work for
Buttigieg? I don't know. It's an interesting development, because I wouldn't have thought that until Buttigieg's recent surge, which comes out of nowhere.
Yeah,
it's just so strange.
So thank you, Chris D'Elisa, who spends like a quarter of his time talking about how Buttigieg is number three.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
I don't know what, I mean, it's weird. He is like Buttigieg math or Buttigieg.
There should be like a pope of conventional wisdom.
Yeah.
Right?
Of idiotic conventional wisdom.
Would that be D'Elisa? I think it would.
I guess, seeing,
he interned for George Will, by the way. Did I tell you that?
Did he?
Yeah, he was George Will's intern.
The Democratic primary is just further example of the kind of establishment collapse. They just can't settle on anyone who can push Bernie out, and it's just great to watch.
Yeah.
It's hilarious.
They just keep bringing new freaks in every day who I'd forgot. I forgot about Deval Patrick.
He was a project of
David Axelrod, and like basically they repurposed his speeches for Obama. He gave the same speeches.
I mean, he's the 28th person to jump into the race on the Democratic side. You know, somebody from AmeriQuest and Bain Capital. Like, are you serious? It just shows the total.
Well-rounded.
Yeah, I mean, the total lack of imagination and the inability to recognize that they can't seem to figure out that none of these people are going to work. you know? Yeah.
So here's a bold prediction. Hillary enters as a third party candidate against Bernie Sanders and helps the Republican win.
Wow.
Oh my God.
That would be great.
That would be, that's like,
I'm
a
not officially
Bruckheimer
predicting
movie.
That. Right. I'm just throwing that out there.
What is your prediction for next year?
I can't make one. I just think we'll just see further, you know, evidence of establishment collapse, contradictions exploding. Trump's base has narrowed out substantially, and there's a lot of energy against Trump. So Democratic turnout could put anyone over the top. But it's hard to imagine Elizabeth Warren matching up well against Trump. It's hard to imagine Joe Biden, you know.
Not sunsetting, like the Patriot Act.
That's right. It's a comeback.
Yeah.
Joe Biden's just, you know, he's sort of, it's
turn on, get on the phone.
Yeah, get on the phone. What did he say?
Turn on the record player.
He was like, turn on the record player, but then he says, get on the phone, and nobody heard him say that.
I know, he starts
talk to your kids. 4,000 people who talk to their kids do so. You know, I'm like,
that's so pretty good.
Black kids, I mean, poor, what is he saying?
Black kids, black kids. I mean, it's just a comedy show. I'm glad he's out there. I almost feel sorry for him if he wasn't such a heinous person had, you know, never met a war he didn't like. You know, he proposed bulldozing raves.
Oh my God, really?
He delivered this rant on the Senate floor calling for, we're going to enforce the crack house policy on these raves. Bring out the bulldozers and destroy the raves.
That's awesome.
It was like, you know, Ariel Sharon coming down on like a refugee camp of raves. Like,
he should enter each speech on a bulldozer.
Yeah.
You know
well,
I mean?
He actually eulogized Ariel Sharon at his funeral and referred to him fondly as the bulldozer.
Oh, I could so see him. The old bulldozer.
I think this is more of a local problem. If I were governor of my state or mayor of my town, I would be passing new ordinances relating to stiff criminal penalties for anyone who held a rave, the promoter, the guy who owned the building. I would put the son of a gun in jail. I would change the law. But we're afraid to do that because we affect commercial interests. They get kind of shaky when we do that. I would be moving vigorously. It's no, you can ask, my cops are going to come and testify. And you know your folks. There's no doubt about where these raves are. In the middle of the desert. Arrest the promoter. Find a rationale unrelated to drugs. Keeping an unsafe example. I'm the guy who authored the crack house legislation. We can use the crack house legislation to tear down these buildings.
Just bring him into the desert.
He basically said, fabricate a rationale.
I know.
Find the rationale.
And, you know.
Can we make Find the Rationale t-shirts?
Biden 2020?
Yeah.
Biden 2020. Find the rationale.
Find the rationale. Actually, that's hilarious.
That's perfect.
Find the rationale.
Oh, my God. We just got the winning slogan.
We have to
make that.
The bleeding eyes.
Yeah, the bleeding eye. Yeah.
Find the rationale.
He's talking about the crack house legislation. On a less funny note, he's talking about the crack house legislation. It's the whole, like, you know, establishment freak out about crack houses. And, you know, I was thinking about Biden when I was, you know, doing my little two-day hiatus in jail, you know, seeing, you know, 70 young black men in a cage for basically being poor, doing nothing.
Right.
That's Biden's legacy.
Yeah, he used to brag about it.
He bragged about it. He rammed that through in the Senate. And so he needs to be...
Every minor major crime bill has this senator's name on it.
Yeah. What Kamala Harris did in her little, you know, DA position, Biden did on a national level, and that's his legacy.
He opened doors for people like Kamala Harris.
Yeah,
she was.
He opened prison doors.
Yeah, he closed prison doors. Well, he opened them to get people in, then closed them.
Find
the rationale.
So yeah, I don't really have a prediction, and that.
If you had to bet on the field, or somebody who's not currently in the race,
that's a good question.
To win the presidency next year, who would you bet on?
You know, I'm just not going to do that. It's
you
not going to go
I like
well.
The way you take your bets really seriously. You take your predictions seriously.
I prefer to bet on myself, and that's about it. Like, if you want to play one-on-one, like, I'll bet on myself.
This is the hardest gambling election of all time.
Yeah.
I don't think it's even close. Like, the because, just as you say, Trump's base is smaller. The numbers look bad for him right now if you're just looking at the polls. But it's just impossible to imagine him one-on-one against almost anybody and losing. In other words, like, you know, Bernie I can see winning, yeah. You know, a broad thing, but Warren, Biden, it's just so hard to see
I cannot see Warren. That, you know, him, whenever he starts a narrative that everyone is offended by in the liberal intelligentsia about a candidate, you know that he's onto something, right. And that it's very effective, and it will fall on fertile soil. Yes. So 2 days before Hillary Clinton collapsed on 9/11 in the heat and was like seen shaking, Trump started raising questions about her health.
Yeah, he taps into it. He's like the something whisperer. Yeah.
He was like, how dare he? You know, he's lying. And he said he was being wiretapped, and they're like, he's the conspiracist in chief. They would have those chyrons on CNN. He was being wiretapped. But anyway, he's this narrative about Warren and Pocahontas.
Yeah,
that's real. She perpetrated racial fraud, and she will never be able to live it down.
Yeah.
And she potentially took advantage of an affirmative action program and replaced a qualified Native American Indian student from being able to get into Harvard Law.
Right,
she said a lot of very weird and dishonest
plus her
things.
Recipe for powwow chow,
yeah,
which we still have to.
And then big structural Bailey. I mean, it's just, she's just kind of like a smug dork who you could imagine in a administrative meeting at Harvard, but I can't imagine her in a debate with Trump.
Well, she wouldn't do very good against Scott Brown, and she didn't even do well with Amy Goodman. I mean, if that got her so flustered, if Amy Goodman got her so flustered when she mentioned, you know, the order of the primaries,
Did you see her on Pod Save America with this, like, apparatchik?
Yeah, so what happened? Pod Save America, which one of the Johns on that show says that, you know, with Venezuela, it's one of the cases where Trump is actually right.
Quick to turn to some foreign policy, if that's okay.
I'm ready.
Okay. So there is a humanitarian crisis in Venezuela. Mm-hmm. People are literally starving to death. Hospitals don't have, like, gauze or Band-Aids, like the most basic supplies.
Yep.
The Trump administration has recognized the National Assembly President Juan Guaido as the president and encouraged a bunch of other countries to follow suit. And frankly, what was a pretty impressive diplomatic play by them. He also sanctioned Venezuela's oil industry, which is a major step, which could cut off all their supply of dollars and their ability to, you know, have an economy. Do you agree with those two steps, recognizing Guaido and the sanctions on the oil sector? And if so, I mean, how do we back up a step as bold as saying there's a new president and it's this guy that we named, especially given our history in Latin America?
So I want to broaden this one out just a little bit. Start with the fact that Maduro is obviously a dictator. He's terrible. He's stolen this election. It's a nightmare. It's a nightmare for the people of Venezuela. So that's part one. Part two, this notion of using our diplomatic tools, I'm all for it. I think recognition, I think getting our allies to do it, it's a way to bring diplomatic pressure. Economic sanctions, yeah, I support economic sanctions, but now we're going to start. We got to turn the dial some here. We have to offer humanitarian help at the same time. We can't let people starve. It doesn't matter that Maduro's willing to let his own people starve.
Yeah, so that basically just tells you that she knew nothing about foreign policy going in, and her brain was hijacked by the think tank blob in Washington, D.C. And so this guy, this apparatchik, starts out, who is it, Tommy Vitor or whatever? You know, he says that, first of all, he praises Trump's foreign policy. And he said that the best part of it is that they've been preventing Venezuela from having an economy. So he admits that U.S. Unilateral coercive measures, sanctions, are destroying the lives of average Venezuelans and helping to fuel the migration crisis. And then Warren comes in and first of all tells a series of lies that Maduro stole the election. He did not. It was a free and fair election, according to the former Spanish Prime Minister Zapatero, who monitored it. The African Union monitored it, the CARICOM, the Caribbean states monitored it, and there were international observers. But the reason that they say it was stolen was because the U.S.-backed right-wing extremist opposition boycotted the elections and got many other political parties to boycott. So the one major opposition candidate, Henry Falcón, when he decided to run for the good of Venezuela and Venezuelan democracy against Maduro, the U.S. threatened to sanction him for running in the election because they want to delegitimize Venezuela's democratic institution. Mm. So Warren, she doesn't know any of that. She never will. She's just going along to get along. And then she says that we should fuel the migration crisis even further by continuing to destroy the economy within Venezuela, by imposing a blockade on it while incentivizing people to leave by providing them with aid on the Colombian side. And that, to me, highlights the danger of Elizabeth Warren, where you've basically gone to like a cryonics lab with Hillary's brain and implanted it in hers on foreign policy. And I guess she wants to do big structural change, but here you see big structural Bailey rolling over for IMF readjustment.
Rolling over, that was good.
Yeah.
Rolling over for IMF structural readjustment policy.
Right. Well done, yeah. So let's talk about your reporting on Bolivia, what's happening in Bolivia, and also the reporting that you guys have been doing at the Gray Zone on Bolivia.
Well, again, what we have been trying to do is to fill in the gaps of the rest of Western media, because, as I said before, the kind of most dangerous propaganda is what's left unsaid. And in this situation, not only do you have an undemocratic coup where a unpopular, previously unknown right-wing figure who said her dream is to rid her country of indigenous people has been vaulted into the presidency. In violation of the Constitution. Not only do you have the Organization of American States, this cat's paw for imperialism, run by a fanatic, Luis Almagro, declaring that there was electoral fraud without any clear evidence or basis. Not only do you have the Bolivian military running out the first indigenous president before he was even able to finish his term,
right,
after clearly winning an election, you have fascism, which has been a traditional element of Bolivian society and politics since the end of World War II, when many people started to emigrate to Bolivia from who were Nazi collaborators in Europe or Nazis themselves. When in the 1950s, Klaus Barbie, a Gestapo torturer who tortured communists in France and Jews and others, was given safe haven in Bolivia and repurposed by the CIA as part of Operation Condor to prevent socialism in Latin America. And so what we did in our first piece on Bolivia was to expose the real face and voice of the coup, the person who mobilized the right-wing masses in Bolivia, who was coordinating closely with the U.S., Luis Fernando Camacho. He was first the for 2 years, between his when he was 22 and 24, the leader of a group called the Unión Juvenil Crucenista, UJC, which is a fascist paramilitary based in Santa Cruz, which is the, you know, biggest city in Bolivia, but it's also the financial capital, yeah, where his family runs a natural gas cartel.
Whiter than other cities.
You basically, the country's divided between the indigenous majority in El Alto, and you have the, you know, whiter and mestizo middle-class population who just hate
indigenous. Yeah, yeah.
They hate indigenous people. Yeah. They consider them Satanists.
Yeah, this new president called them satanic. Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, Camacho's UJC, you know, they emerged from these fascist elements I described in the 50s. They're, you know, getting money from Croatian-Bolivian oligarchs with ties to the Ustasha, which helped occupy Croatia on behalf of Nazi Germany. And they Sieg Heil. And so we produced video of this youth group Sieg Heiling. And then they, you know, they do other obvious fascist phalange style Roman salutes. And they also beat indigenous people in the streets. They were the street muscle that helped push the coup. And then you have the Santa Cruz Coordination Committee, which the U.S. was funding. And they run a separatist movement. They want to divide Bolivia because they don't want to be part of a country where the indigenous masses have the right to vote and advance their interests, even though they help power that economy. And Evo Morales was a very successful leader economically. He brought the country together into this kind of, with this plurinational vision. And now you see
Lowered poverty rates
massively. Same thing, by the way, you see with the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, where they've also faced a similar coup but defeated it. And now you see soldiers ripping the huipala off of their uniforms.
Which
the
huipala
is the symbol of the indigenous nation. And this is very emotional for a lot of indigenous people. I mean, they're seeing the symbol of their nation being burned in the streets.
Is this killed. The dicey part that Clara Jeffrey was talking about.
This is the dicey.
It's the dicey part.
You know, Evo was dicey. It's dicey times. But Evo did a lot of runarounds with democracy, and runs around democracy. Yeah.
Yeah. So you know, the New York Times editorial board
endorsed the coup.
The Economist called it like a self coup. I mean, then you have all of these, you know, idiot kind of elite liberals who are like, you know, Morales, he wasn't Democratic.
Right.
It's a, sort of
Chris
a victory
Murphy,
for democracy.
Clara Jeffrey, Kenneth Roth, then all
Ken
the people
Roth, regime
from
change
Human
Roth.
Rights Watch,
yeah.
who are now saying, you know, let's make sure that there's democracy and there's no violence. It's a little late.
Yeah, and so, you know, a few days later, the resistance mobilizes, like the real resistance.
Yeah.
The social movements get their act together and they start marching. You know, the cocaleros, the coca farmers who represent the union that Evo Morales led and helped, you know, establish him as a national leader, the unions, teachers, working class people across the country start to mobilize, especially from the country, and march on the cities to demand their democracy back. And they get mowed down by a military and security forces, which, as we reported at the Gray Zone,
right.
through a really important piece by our contributor Jeb Sprague, we're trained at the School of the Americas, which is basically the insurrection education academy that's been involved in every coup in Latin America.
Oldie but a goodie.
Yeah
oldie
yeah.
but a goodie.
Yeah.
Well, they renamed themselves WINSEC.
Right.
They have a new name.
Yeah. So. How many people have been killed now?
Well, it's up to 24, maybe more, hundreds wounded. And now you kind of see this people who the people who endorsed the coup, they're like, eh.
Yeah, including, did you guys see Elizabeth Warren's? She has a great tweet about this, Elizabeth Warren. The Bolivian people deserve free and fair elections as soon as possible. Bolivia's interim leadership must limit itself to preparing for an early legitimate election. Bolivia's security forces must protect demonstrators, not commit violence against them. But you know what I was thinking when I saw that? Let's go back to 1973, Chile, right? The Chilean people, you could do the same thing after Allende was killed. The Chilean people deserve free and fair elections as soon as possible. Chile's interim leadership must limit itself to preparing for an early legitimate election. Chile's security forces must protect demonstrators,
the
not
Shah
commit violence
supporting.
Against
I mean,
them.
You know.
Right? You could do the same thing. I mean, to be fair, Allende was actually killed. Morales just had his house ransacked and fled under threat of violence. And this isn't funny, but it's terrible. They have footage of his house being ransacked, and then you hear people who are filming it. They're like, "Ay, qué gimnasio más increíble!"
Yeah, and
they're
it's
"Look at this great, amazing
it's
gym."
It's just like a treadmill that,
yeah,
like,
and
it's
sneakers,
not like
yeah.
it's not like a Peloton
I
that
know.
Like every, you know, housewife in a McMansion
right.
in the exurbs
yeah.
has.
Anyway, but that's yeah. I mean, this is a ridiculously embarrassing tweet, which again shows. Maybe if it had been done like earlier on. I mean, the thing is that like people have reported like the stuff that you reported at the Gray Zone. If the New York Times had reported on the racist tweets of this new president, Añez, or her holding a huge Bible, like a Bible for like kids.
It was just unbelievable. It was, yeah, it's like a Bible for people who can't see very
yeah,
well.
Exactly.
It's like,
yeah, exactly.
The
huge.
Letters are huge.
Yeah.
It's like, and then Jehoshaphat begat,
yeah.
you know, so and so. The New York Times called her a conservative Christian who is possibly divisive. It's like
possibly, yeah. They're also doing the both sides is with
yeah.
the race stuff. How both she and Evo Morales.
They said that Morales, for calling it a coup and pointing out that their racism is deepening the divide.
Right. Yeah.
They just, you know, the reporters at the New York Times use that
disgusting.
Exact language. So again, the propaganda is also about what's not being said, and we're trying to kind of fill the void and break the media blockade. We have a contributor in Bolivia now, Wyatt Reed, so definitely follow his Twitter account and look for his dispatches. We'll be reporting from the ground in Bolivia and showing a very different side of events than, you know,
the papers that kill
our democracy in darkness. And
yeah, exactly.
All right,
yeah.
Max, thanks so much for coming on.
Thank
really,
you.
It was great.
Yeah, and everyone read The Management of Savagery. Great book.
Good luck at your status hearing.
Yeah.
I'll be updating, and thanks everyone for supporting me on that.
That was great.
It really was.
It really was. I'm so thankful for that. And speaking of which, next week we're off because it's Thanksgiving.
But that doesn't mean we're not going to have things for you to listen to
right.
and watch.
Which, including part two of our interview with Max Blumenthal.
And more exploration of farts and other things?
Yeah. Hearts and farts, they fade away, like Pearl Jam says.
All right. Well, thank you for tuning in.
Yeah.
And we'll see you next week.
Yeah. And remember, blame all your farts, any farts that happen on Thanksgiving or any other time, on moving
that's right that's
mugs.
Right don't move your mug around
these. Yeah.
yeah
yeah don't move your mug around or do move it around yeah.